Any other boys?
The youth is thankful for Christmas break coming up and the trip to Edgewood.
Praise God. Any others?
My CV number was undetectable the last time.
Prayer concerns.
Gone is shame.
Gone is shame. Michelle.
My birthday.
Your birthday. Today's your birthday?
29th.
Michelle's having a birthday. Any other birthdays?
Crystal Haynes had one this month.
Crystal Haynes had one this month. Crystal and Michelle, any others? Let's sing happy birthday. Pray for Donna Shea and Teresa so far.
I have a praise. I've been with my bride now 35 years tomorrow.
How do you do it, Jane? What's your secret?
They just asked me.
I
thought they were
just
asking.
April and Scotty Lane.
Any? For Leroy Stewart and his family and for Mike Steinbeck.
Mike Steinbeck?
Yes. Leroy's preparing to meet his Savior.
What was his last name?
Stewart.
Leroy Stewart family?
Yes, Leroy. He hasn't passed yet, but got a hold of his hand.
Oh, Leroy Stewart. Any others?
Have a praise. My brother-in-law Eric and Marcy got married Friday.
We have anniversaries, we have weddings. Wow, there's so much to praise God for. Any others?
Traveling mercies.
Traveling Mercies. Church Family. Mason Burns Family.
Diane Roy.
Unspoken requests. Let's go to prayer. Gracious and merciful God, we take this moment to just give you thanks and praise for everything that you do in our lives. Father, we just lift up all these joys to you at this time. Father, we just give you the praise. We just thank you for how you bless our lives through family and through trips, through our youth, through all our young people that are in this church here this morning. And even those that aren't able to be here, we just give you thanks and praise for them. We thank you for those that are visiting us. We thank you for being able to gather together and sing Christmas carols at a bonfire. Father, we thank you and praise you for giving us safe travels, and we continue to pray for traveling mercies for all those that will be traveling during this Christmas season and even the new year. Father, we do thank you and praise you for getting us here this morning to gather together to be with our church family and sing praises and worship you. Father, we pray for families throughout our community that are still and now grieving the loss of a loved one. We pray for the Hetrick family, the Nicewanger family, the Sherry family, and the Burns family. Father, we pray that they can find their peace and their comfort from you. May it just rain down upon them as you have promised when we turn to you and cry out to you. Father, we pray that these families can find their strength and their courage through you and your son, through their relationship with you. May they turn to your living and inspired word to give them courage to get through the mourning and the grieving process. Father, we pray for all those that are listed in our bulletin, each name, each individual. We lift the names up of the ones that were mentioned here this morning, the names of Donna and Teresa, April, Scotty, Mike, Leroy, and Diane. Father, we pray for your healing and anointing touch upon them. You know them personally, individually. You know them intimately. You know all the circumstances. We just turn them over to you, praying with expectation and anticipation of your answered prayer. Father, at this time, we will take a moment of silence to offer up our unspoken requests. Father, we also praise you and thank you for the giving of yourself. We're soon to celebrate the Christmas day, your son's birthday, the day that you sent him to come to this earth, a part of you through your love for us, so that we could have freedom from sin. Father, we just thank you and praise you for that. And we also praise you for the life lessons and everything that he taught us while he was here on earth. And so long ago, He taught us how to pray. So let us close in prayer with that pray that so many pray. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. And now I will call upon thee.
Jesus was told in the second chapter of Luke in the New Testament.
In ancient times, the Roman ruler ordered a count to be taken of all the people who lived in the Roman Empire. Each person went to the town where he was born to be counted.
In ancient, Joseph left his home in Nazareth and traveled to Bethlehem. His wife Mary, who was expected her first baby, went with him.
While they were in Bethlehem, Mary gave birth to a baby boy. They were staying in a stable because there were no rooms left for them to rent. Mary wrapped the baby in a soft blanket and placed him on the straw in the manger.
Outside the city, shepherds were sleeping in the field so they could protect their flocks of sheep. God sent an angel to tell the shepherds the great news, but then the angel was shining so brightly that the shepherds were afraid.
The angel spoke to the shepherds and told them he was bringing them wonderful news that was for all the people on earth.
Today in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is Christ the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find the baby wrapped in cloth and lying in a manger.
Suddenly, more angels appeared, and they were all praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace, goodwill toward men." There they found Mary and Joseph and the baby, who was lying in a manger, just as the angel had told them. The shepherds were so amazed by all this that they told everyone they saw about that blessed new baby.
Mary was happy. She kept these memories and treasured them in her heart.
Returning to the fields, the shepherds were also happy and praising God for all the wonderful things they had heard and seen. Tell the good news too. And so one way to do that is we have ornaments that have a cross on them. And so when the kids put them on their tree, they can be reminded of the manger scene and what God has given to all of us. And so can you help me pass these out? Even if they're big kids, they can still have them. So you might want to start back here in the back.
statues over here. We just pray that they will go out into the world and spread your good news as the shepherds did those many, many years ago. We pray that you will be with them. Amen.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Well, being chair of PPR, I have the pleasure of presenting a small token of our appreciation to some special people in our church, and they are Bill Young, Dave Green, Debbie Green, and Matthew Green. If they could all gather around, other than Dave, you can stay where you're at. Well, as you know, from video and sound by Matthew, to the direction of our beautiful choir and bells by Bill, and the beautiful music played by Dave and Debbie Green, you have all been called and accepted positions in our church. Each of you, with your gifts and abilities, make our Christian experience that much more uplifting. So from all of us here at First Church, we wish you all a Merry Christmas.
I want to thank all of everyone who helps in any way for our worship services and any of our church functions. Thank you to all of our employees. Allison Kaida, a writer for our Daily Bread Ministries, writes, "I'm fast approaching a new season, the winter of old age, but I'm not there yet." She says that although the years are galloping by, and I'd really like to slow them down, it is joy that keeps me going. Each day is a new day that the Lord has given me, and I find it important to live as the psalmist wrote in Psalm 92, verses 1 through 2, when it says, "It is good to praise the Lord, proclaiming your love in the morning and your faithfulness at night." She says her life is full of struggles and the pain and difficulties she experiences with others oftentimes overwhelms her. She says, "I always try to, as the psalmist sings, sing for joy at what his hands have done." Allison tries to find joy in everything that God gives her or sends her away. Joy in family, joy in friends, and joy in her work. She finds joy in God's creation, his inspired word, the fact that Jesus loved her so much that he died for her. Allison also finds joy in the fact that God gave us his Holy Spirit, the source of true joy. She says, and I quote, "No matter our circumstances or season of life, we can be examples of his love through the life we lead and the words we say. There is joy in knowing and living for the Lord and telling others about him." Our passage that God chose for us this morning is a continuation of the Prophets of a Savior sermon series. And it comes from Zephaniah chapter 3, verses 14 through 20. Let us hear God's word for us this morning. Sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. Rejoice and exult with all your heart, O daughter Jerusalem. The Lord has taken away the judgments against you. He has turned away your enemies. The King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. On that day it shall be said to Jerusalem, do not fear, O Zion. Do not let your hands grow weak. The Lord your God is in your midst, a warrior who gives victory. He will rejoice over you with gladness. He will renew you in his love. He will exult over you with loud singing, as on a day of festival. I will remove disaster from you so that you will not bear reproach for it. I will deal with all your oppressors at that time. And I will save the lame and gather the outcast. And I will change their shame into praise and renown in all the earth. At that time I will bring you home, at the time when I gather you. For I will make you renowned and praised among all the peoples of the earth, when I restore your fortune before your eyes, says the Lord. These are the words of God for the people of God. Thanks be to God. Pray with me. Father, we thank you for your word that you chose for us this morning. And we pray at this time that your Spirit will anoint us, opening our minds and softening our hearts to the message that you have given your servant to share with your people. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Our passage is actually subtitled A Song of Joy. And in this passage, Zephaniah concludes his prophecy with a song of joy that Israel and Jerusalem is expected to voice. We can divide this passage into three parts. The first part, verses 14 through 16, speaks of God's presence and our need to praise Him. The second part, verses 17 through 18, is a message of restoration and salvation. And the last part, verses 19 through 20, speaks both prophetically and apocalyptically. Like Allison Kayak, Zephaniah speaks about rejoicing and praising, for God is our joy. He says, sing aloud, O daughter Zion. Shout, O Israel. He says, God has removed your judgments and turned your enemies away. He is present in the city. Verse 15 states, the King of Israel, the Lord, is in your midst. You shall fear disaster no more. Remember, the Lord is in our midst. This morning, all around the world, Christians are celebrating the lighting of the joy candle. Joy being one of the virtues that Christ brings to us as believers. The other three are hope, peace, and love. But are all Christians full of joy this morning? Are you full of joy this morning? Were the Israelites full of joy in this passage? Most likely not. During the time of Zephaniah, as was the time of Malachi, whom we talked about last Sunday, Jerusalem and Judah were struggling greatly in their faith and journey with God. After King Hezekiah's death, his son Manasseh abandoned his father's godly ways and rebuilt the places of idolatry that his father had destroyed. He killed many innocent people, and he even sacrificed one of his very own sons to one of the many gods that he worshipped. Amon, Manasseh's son, followed in his father's footsteps. At the time of Zephaniah, Judah was under Assyrian control, which eventually fell to a coalition of nations that were under Babylonian rule. And eventually, Babylon came to rule over Judah. God had been patient with his rebellious people for a very long time. He sent many prophets to warn his people of the coming judgment. God's message to his people was, the day of reckoning, the day of the Lord, was drawing near. So God raises up the prophet Zephaniah to warn the people by using some very strong language and telling them that no nation, not even Judah, can escape God's judgment. This raises a very important and profound question. How much wickedness will God tolerate before he brings judgment upon his people? In a more contemporary view, how much longer will God allow the things that are going on in America before he brings judgment upon the American people? Remember, the Lord is in our midst. Now let me explain and clarify something here. I'm not placing America and its people in with the covenant between God and Israel by that question. Israel and the Jewish people are and always will be God's chosen nation and people. But I do believe God held a special place in his heart for America and its citizens. I believe our nation has been blessed by God from the very first time a European set foot on its shores. He blessed this nation because our founding was based on our newly reformed faith in God, his inspired and living word, and the American people who lived out the principles of Christianity for centuries. God made America into a world power. He made America into an economic power. God blessed America to be a leader in education, industry, science and technology, world defense, and religious freedom. But America has changed. Many say not for the better. Americans have now compromised their principles of faith. God's word is no longer revered anymore. It's no longer held sacred anymore. In fact, we are now going in reverse of what and how our nation was founded. We have actually removed God and his word from our daily lives, from our schools, and from our public buildings. Our currency says on it, "In God we trust," a statement any American could once say freely, but now would be afraid to say because they might be persecuted for it. They may be sued for being intolerant or a bigot. Sorry, my nose is running on me. Today, we idolize other gods. Gods of career and occupation. Gods of recreation. Gods of sports. Gods of entertainment and beauty. We now have no time for the one and only God. God, the creator of everything that we have and enjoy. God, the creator, ironically, of the things that pull us away from him. We no longer fear or respect God. And as a result, our churches are dying because of reduced membership and attendance. They were closing at an astronomical rate. Astronomical rate. Thank you. Throughout our nation. I think God's telling me to settle down. We have become just like the Israelites that Zephaniah is speaking.